Good morning. So now I'm back to talking about the bedrolls for the winter laundering. I actually have woven already two bedrolls. They're made specifically out of wool. I have this one, it's much lighter than the other. It's not tightly woven, it's more puffy. And so it's a lot lighter to carry. Now, if I go with the bedroll, the made out of wool, you know, it's not absolutely completely a sleeping bag, but I don't know, carrying a sleeping bag just kind of ruins me, doesn't it? It goes back to, well, the commercialism that got me there, you know, the commercialism that has gotten me there. So I don't know. This is something I made, and so perhaps this is better. You know, this is a better sleeping bag. Now, if it's going to keep me warm on the under, that's what we have to think about. You know, we have to think: does it keep me warm on the under? Because it has to. I have to fit in here. You know, I have to fit inside. So it's kind of like the old coma sacks. Remember those? You used to have those coma sacks. Wrap yourself up real tight. So I'm leaning towards this over the Pendleton, and I don't know. I have another knit blanket I'm desperate to take also. So I'm leaning towards this one, but I'll show you my other one. See, I have the Pendleton all ready to go. It's already wrapped up. I already wrapped it more pro. It's with the knit, and then I put the plastic, and then I have a green screen in here also, just for fun, and inclusive some end sacks, and so then that will just balance. This is just going to balance on top of the Kilimanjaro sack, like that. So I have the plan. Where is the Kilimanjaro? Here. Yeah, so it's going to balance there. I tried to show you yesterday, but maybe it was hard to see with me there also. So it balances that kind of like, I don't know, you can go, gosh dang, you know, like in Africa, they put so much on their head. I don't know how they put all that on their head. It's just incredible to me. But yeah, I'll do this, and then I'll wrap a bungee around. And so then it has its... And so I'm back to single sack with a wrap top bedroll. So it does work. It does work that way. But is it enough? Is it enough? You know, this and a coat. You know, this is my big fret on. I have a lot of wool, heavy wool socks. I have a lot of heavy wool socks and that I knitted specifically. So I'm thinking that's a major extremity, so I've got to think about extremities, hands and socks, you know, being extremely important to keep warm. All right. Now here's the other bedroll I made, which is a lot tighter. You notice it's denser. It's a tighter roll. It's more like a tipees, more like a carpet. I'll try to get closer with it. If you see all the little braids, it actually took me about a year to make, so I don't really want to leave them behind. And originally you're supposed to take these and put them on the back of, it can be a camel, you can put them on the back of a horse. That's just really the purpose for it, and so it's your bedroll that you can take anywhere, and you know, keep that cold ground away. So I really needed to take this also. And I know I feel like I'm talking past tense, you know, I'm like the angel talking to herself has already died. When you're into all the braids, it is quite beautiful. It is quite beautiful. So it did quite take me a little bit of time, but you know, beauty is in the eye of the beholder, isn't it? And you know, maybe it's too old fashioned, you know, it's too Iceland or something, you know, it's too I don't know, what do you call it? It's just too much work, you know. Gee whiz, why would a human being do that? You know, and then the fact is I have to abandon it, so it's a bit of a bummer. So as I'm, when I'm facing materialism, I'm actually facing what I have created, what I have done, you know, my little handiworks that I will have to leave. And this is one of them. This is one of them, you know. And, you know, I've got little designs in there and everything. So it's like, well, you know, it's just life. It's just life. You know, they're just items. They're just like a time spent. It was a time spent. And you go on. So I'm really looking at using the fat boy. But yeah, the fat boy, gosh dang, it's lighter. But it, you know what? Inside, as well, but also Shnu and Ru, a little bit of their dog fur. So I have my friends with me. Also. It has a little bit of that touch of the past that actually meant something to me. So that was not a bad past. So it's good to take something like that, I think, over, I know, I really like the Pendleton, but I'm thinking, I'll go show you the blank, it's not the one I have, I'll go get it really quick, I think. Yeah, see the Pendletons themselves, they're just your basic, I don't know, it's a real tight one. It's a little tight thick, but you know, and you can wrap it maybe two times, three times. But it's not going to have the same pouncy. It's not going to have the same pouncy of fat as this other. And it's heavier. It's actually heavier. It's a slightly heavier when I'm going through it all. So as much as I love this density. Oh yeah, this is serious talk here. Any cold air coming through, and so this is my dilemma, you know, because I've got the cold air not coming through here, and then I have my creation versus my creation, you know, but then I'm like, wait a minute, this worked for the Siberian Huskies, you know, it works for the who? Yeah, you know, this was my first one I made, so I was just really puffy with it. And I guess, I don't know, where does the tighter weave come from all of a sudden? Why did I switch to the other one? Not sure. But, they're odd little creatures to make, for sure. Yeah, and they're not beautiful by modern standards, perhaps. Not beautiful at all. But, I don't know. Bedroll and a blanket. So it is kind of got that atmosphere. These are Corsican brabies. They call them brabies. Fur, little wool here. So yeah. So I guess I'm leaning towards it. I'm leaning towards this as the lighter bedroll to carry. So yeah, pretty funny. Now, yeah, and so then I did take away the artisan hemp sack last night, and I've readjusted. And I put all of my clothes now into a secondary. So now I have the single, and then I'm going to have a secondary. Now the secondary is going to be swung out, and when you have the secondary swung out, this is all, you know, changing my alignment and everything. It would be really cool. See, it's about getting off the ground with all of this item. If I did have Velcro, I could have Velcroed this side here, and Velcroed the other side of that sack. And so when I raise up, you know, then I could Velcro this in, and so that would have been like an instant attachment. So that's a way to think about not having such a loose one, you know what I mean? I hate that jug off the shoulder. So yeah, but then this, yeah, wouldn't that be great if it was just that? but it can't be just that, you know, it just can't be that, just that. There's just way too many other things. But I do have in here already, I have the shovel, I have my little gardening shears, I have water, you know, what clothes remain, and aside from the other original food sack. So it's I'm getting there, for sure. Yeah, so I guess I'm gonna toss out the Pendleton. That's my big I don't know, what do you call it? I guess I have this hat. I got it at REI a long time ago, and it's just an old rain hat, old kebabber or something. So the water droplets go off. And then on top of everything else, I have a lot of plastic. You have to carry plastic. You have to wrap your bedrolls in plastic. Oh, I know, I'm like a freaking expert already. Wrap that in plastic. Nothing can get wet. This is such a wet region here with the rain. When I said there's probably like a 3-day limit on staying, you know, as you go, I think when the rain applies, you're allowed to wait until the rain has cleared out quite a bit, and it's a much drier day. I don't believe they can push you out. And like I said, you know, maybe we can coordinate some areas in France where to stay, what to stay, where are the places that we can go and just have our tents, because there's no way we can't afford the camping. We cannot afford the camping any longer. We can't afford the housing. We can't afford even working in their system. Actually, when it comes down to it, a system is a supply and demand, and there always has to be unemployed people. There always has to be unemployed people. The way the system is set up now, the way the economy is set up, it demands unemployed people. Now, those unemployed people are the witness of how much is on supply, how much has been trickling out through purchases, how much people want. Now, when those people don't want any longer, when they are oversupplied, overstocked, they lose their jobs. The jobs go, the companies fall because they have overstock. Now, when all of that is going on, that means I'm more unemployed. And so that's the way the system works. So the overstock creates unemployment. Now, unemployment creates people out into the streets. And that's just the way it goes, out into the regions of the world, camping and tenting, and they don't have any money. So I think any grown adult has to realize that anytime you see a homeless person, anytime you see a person who doesn't have any money, don't get angry at them. They're just an absolute have to of the economy. It's a rise and fall event. It's an absolute have to of the economy. We have to have unemployed people. That's the way the system works. Otherwise, we will have cameras in every aspect of our home and demanding that you purchase only this amount and only that amount. And that would be the future that we go toward, that you do not, that you're not allowed to have 5 extra blankets in your house, that you're not allowed to have, you know, 6 computers, that you're only allowed 1, you're only allowed 3 blankets, you know what I'm saying? That would be the only way to make sure there wouldn't be unemployment. So we're not really headed in that direction. It's a consumer market, and so it is volatile. And so when you see people that are homeless, try to keep that in mind, that they're walking the volatile walk, that you support it. So don't be angry at them. Okay, so anyway. Happy with that little, what do you call that, day trader talk? Well, here we go with this day trade. I'm just loving this decision. I will commend it. I know this is a rough talk, but this is called the dog bed, Now, this is a little dog bed that fits inside one of those sleeping bag sacks. And this is absolutely possible to use. So don't denounce it. Don't denounce these little dog beds at all. They're good, fat, and they're puffy. And so that's really good for the back. Now, if you're out on the cold and you don't have enough back bedding, you have to support certain areas of your body. Now, right away, you have to support, roll up anything you have, clothing or whatever, and put it right here at the lower back region. Right here at the lower back region. And then you put one a little higher if you need it. But really, it's the lower back region. Just try to keep as much of your spine away from the floor, away from the ground, and raise that up. And then keep your, if you can, try to also raise your feet up a little bit. So you have your feet, you have this area, and then up in here. And so then you're set, And then something for your head. So you actually have just like three or four places to actually keep off the ground. Try to just sleep that way. I know it's kind of like on a balance beam, that idea, but going the other way. But that's the answer. That's the answer when you don't have the underroll. Two shoes. I have two pairs of shoes. That's just the way it goes. I've got these new ones, and I appreciate them all. But I don't know, they're just not really that comfortable. As they don't carry as much socks. You know, I can't put as much socks in there. I need to have like three or four pair on sometimes. So I'm taking just the regular old shower shoes, and then you can have three or four pairs of socks on. You just get them extra large, extra large, and. Yeah, okay, that's a long vlog. Sorry about that this morning.